Good morning. Welcome to NASA headquarters. Today is a very special day as we get to hear from Dr. Tracy Caldwell-Dyson and U.S. Army Colonel Doug Wheelock about their experiences at the space station during a combined total of nearly 8 months as crew members of Expeditions 23, 24, and 25. Dr. Caldwell-Dyson launched aboard a Soyuz crew capsule on April 2, 2010 from the Baikonur Cosmodrome and docked to the space station 2 days later. For the next 174 days, Caldwell-Dyson lived and worked aboard the International Space Station as a flight engineer on Expeditions 23 and 24. About 2.5 months later, Colonel Wheelock and fellow crew members launched on June 15th and joined the current crew members as part of the Expedition 24 crew. On July 31st, an ammonia pump failed on the space station, and the crew responded to an emergency shutdown of half of the station's external cooling system. On August 7th, 11th, and 16th, Tracy and Doug performed 3 unplanned spacewalks to replace the faulty pump module that caused the shutdown. During more than 22 hours of spacewalking, their efforts restored the station's critical cooling system to full function. On September 22nd, Wheelock became commander of Expedition 25 as Tracy and Expedition 24 prepared to depart. She and her fellow crew members returned to a safe landing in central Kazakhstan on September 25th, 2010, after 176 days in space. During their expeditions, Tracy and Doug supported microgravity experiments in human research, biology and biotechnology, physical and material sciences, technology development, and Earth and space sciences. Doug and his fellow crew members returned to Earth on Thanksgiving Day after 163 days in space. Please welcome Doug and Tracy.
Thank you. It's obviously a real pleasure for Doug and I to be here today. We wish Shannon could be here with us as well. Shannon Walker was our third U.S. crew member during this whole time frame. But it is, it's an extraordinary thing to have lived in space for a half of a year. But it's even more heartwarming and meaningful to come back and be able to share it with everyone, especially the people who had a direct hand involved in our life, preparing for, executing, and coming home from this mission. So it's with a great deal of pleasure that we're here today. And I can tell you that living in space is really the tip of the iceberg. We do a lot of work to get there, as many of you know. But living there in space is definitely a very extraordinary thing. And we're here to tell you that that International Space Station is the most magnificent creation of the human mind and the human hands that I think I've ever been not only the honor of working inside, but just being in the presence of. And it's worthwhile what we're doing up there. And if it's not the view that you see out the window that inspires you to say that, it's just living there and experiencing the inside from the inside out, as both Doug and I were privileged to do, that brings it home that what we're doing is the right thing up there, and that it's something that we should continue doing.
Absolutely. Well, thanks, Tracy. And as Tracy said, we went into this adventure. I kind of went in with these high hopes and big dreams of bringing the space station to the really to the threshold of what was originally designed for, and that is to be a world-class orbiting laboratory and bring all these laboratory experiments on board. And we had 130 of them going on board at any one given time, and 4 different laboratories. And I think we both sort of looked at the adventure, the start of the adventure, because we had experience on the space shuttle before. So as a test pilot, as my background, I was very anxious to see what it felt like to launch and, of course, land in this little capsule that was quite a bit different than our space shuttle. And I wanted to feel that experience as well, and was excited about that. And then our 6-month mission on the station, we sort of hope that there'd be very little drama. You know, we wanted to bring, we really wanted to usher in the age of science, really, aboard the station, where we could bring all these laboratories up and running and really begin to return that bang for the buck for this past number of years that we've been assembling these laboratories. And so, but then, you know, as space never disappoints, around every corner, there seems to be a surprise lurking for us. And so the space station is a magnificent vehicle, but it's orbiting in an environment that's really, really hostile to the human body, to mechanical pieces of equipment. And, you know, probably the easiest way to describe it is that when you're outside, we're orbiting the Earth actually once every 90 minutes. And so every 45 minutes, you're either getting a sunrise or sunset. And so when you're outside working on the space station, or equipment that's on the outside working on the space station is actually exposed to direct sunlight when the temperatures can get to be about 250 to 300 degrees Fahrenheit. And then when the 45 minutes later, when the space station goes into eclipse, it could be 250 degrees below zero. So it's really, really difficult to go out there and work in these suits that we've designed here at NASA. It's just been terrific insulation and everything, but mechanical pieces of hardware that are working outside sometimes have great surprises for us. And it was July 31st of last year. It was a Saturday evening. We actually live and work our normal day on the space station according to Greenwich Mean Time. So it was a Saturday evening about 11:32 Greenwich in the evening, and we were supposed to be actually in crew sleep at that time, but I think Tracy and I were both still awake, and we had just done some late running on the treadmill and taken some photos of our beautiful planet. And we had just, within the last several minutes, had shut down the treadmill when the alarms went off. And there's something that's really kind of ratchets up the senses when you are inside of a spaceship that slowly starts to shut down before your eyes. And so we kind of looked at each other and we said, well, I think we just shut down the treadmill. Hopefully we didn't shut down the station. But of course it was totally unrelated to the treadmill, but it was a problem that we had trained for. We had, it wasn't something that we were expecting, obviously, but we had trained for it, and we weren't quite sure. We had a couple of different options on how to deal with it. One, using the robotic arm. Both options, going out in a spacewalk, and then using the robotic arm or not using the robotic arm. And Tracy and I had not exercised the contingency spacewalk together in the pool at all, but we had both done it separately on different occasions with another crew member planning for this contingency. And of course, it took us a few minutes to try to figure out what was actually going on. Of course, within just a couple of minutes, everyone was awake. And then the ensuing weeks that Stephanie had described, we ended up doing three spacewalks. We ended up having to shut down essentially most of the laboratory systems on board the station and all of the science. And to see our teams come together, both our international partners and our ground control teams, the folks, our support here at NASA headquarters, it was like something you see in the movies. It really was, and we weren't quite sure how we were going to tackle it, but we looked at each other. We thought, you know what? I've seen this in the movies before, and it really turns out to be a very fine effort by NASA and one of our finest moments. And that it did. It took us three spacewalks. We are outside for 22 hours or something, you know, 23. Something like that. 23 hours, oh, and we got that pump module repaired and actually replaced with a new one that we had on board, and we're able to bring the space station back up and bring our science back on board as well. And it really served to prove as a tribute to our ground training, also our support here at NASA headquarters and all the NASA facilities, as well as our ground control centers and with our international partners. And how we can come together as a team facing this fairly major critical issue on board the space station and coming through in one of NASA's finest hours. And it was a real privilege for us to be a part of that. And I think we're going to show a video. I wanted to introduce the video real quick. The other thing that I was sort of introduced to was tweeting. And I kind of, forgive me, Stephanie, but I kind of went kicking and screaming to the tweeting thing. And I think that I just didn't realize the power of tweeting or this new social media that we're so involved with. And I thought, you know, your life is limited to 140 characters, and so essentially a soundbite. And I thought, you know, I want my experience to be a little bit deeper than that. And what I didn't realize was, it's not the importance of the actual tweet. It's what happens afterward in a global society. And we're able to share the view that we had out the cupola windows, which was just incredible. Hard to describe in words, and so you can't, you know, 140 characters is plenty because you're speechless, essentially. And so to just get it out there in some sort of thought of what's going through your mind, and just let the rest of a global society run with it. And it leads to deep, very profound discussion on the internet and in a segment of society that we traditionally have a difficult time reaching through our experience on the space station. And I actually got in trouble a little bit up front because I was actually tweeting before I was downlinking officially the photos. And so I got a friendly reminder from NASA that said, like, hey, make sure that you downlink the photo before you tweet it, because we're getting a lot of requests for the high resolution photo and we don't have it yet. So I kind of got the cart before the horse, but we got that switched up as well. But one of the things that was kind of neat about our experience on board is that to be able to bring this back to all of you, of course, we wish that we could have you there with us in the cupola, because no words or even a photo can even begin to describe what you see and what you experience as a human, you know, looking back on our planet. And through this experience of sharing it with everyone else on the planet, we've made a lot of friendships, NASA and our mission in particular, due to the criticality of the failure that we had. And we had a global society that rallied around us and sort of underpinned our efforts as we kind of slugged our way through this. And one of those folks I wanted to thank, because the video that we're gonna show is set to music, and it's the music of Five for Fighting, which I happen to really enjoy their music, but John Androsik, the lead singer, or the band himself, is a big fan of NASA now. And so in collaboration with Five for Fighting, we want to present our video to you. It's difficult to take 6 months of your life and boil it down to about 12 minutes, you know, 12 or 14 minutes. And so we've got some of our favorite shots up here, and you'll see kind of experience through music and the power of music, and also the power of video, our critical failure as well, how we reacted to that. And then after we show the video, we'll be open for any questions that you might have. Thank you very much. And I think we're ready to roll the video.
was a man back in 95 whose heart ran out of summers, but before he died, I asked him, wait, what's the sense in life? Come over me, come over me. He said, son, why you gotta sing that tune? Catch a Dylan song or some eclipse of the moon. Let an angel swing and make you swoon. Then you will see, you will see. Then he said, here's a riddle for you. Find the answer. There's a reason for the world, you and I.
And ignition and liftoff. Liftoff of the Soyuz rocket. Shannon Walker, Fyodor Yurchikhin, and Doug Wheelock begin their journey on the 100th launch on behalf of the International Space Station.
Batter swings and the summer flies. As I look into my angel's eyes, a song plays on while the moon is hiding. Over me, something comes over me. I guess we're big and I guess we're small. If you think about it, man, you know we got it all. 'Cause we're all we got on this bouncing ball. And I love you free. I love you free now. Here's a riddle for you. Find the answer. There's a reason for the world, you and I.
Houston, Space Ground 1, we see your messages, and no immediate action required. We'll get back to you when we have more information.
Okay, we're standing by.
Station Houston, Space Ground 1 for ETCS warning.
Chris, go ahead.
We're showing that the Loop Alpha ETCS pump is down. You have no cooling on Loop Alpha. No immediate action for you on the ground. We're going to be stepping into warning 2.820.
And she feels better than ever, and we're on fire, making our way back from my house. 15, there's still time for you. When you only got 100 years to live. half time goes by. Suddenly your eyes, another blink of an eye. 67 is gone, the sun is getting high. We're moving on. I'm not denying for a moment. I'm dying for just another moment. And I'm just dreaming, counting the ways to where you are.
With great honor, I receive and accept command of the International Space Station from you. Thank you. Machine, a magic wand, a globe made out of gold. No instructions or commandments, laws of gravity or indecisions to uphold. Printed on the box I see, Acme's built a world to be. Take a chance, grab a piece, help me to. History starts now. Should there be people or people? Money, funny pedestals for fools who never pay. Raise your army, choose your steeple. Shine the satellites, can look the other way. Lose the earthquakes, keep the faults. Fill the oceans without the salt. Let every man own his own hand. Can you dig it, baby? What kind of world do you want? Think anything. Let's start at the start. Build a master. Relinquish command of the International Space Station to you, my friend and crewmate.
Thank you, Doug. I assume command. It's a real honor and a privilege to take command of this great ship, the International Space Station.
What kind of world do you want? We'll be right back.
It does have the tweets here. I'll let this run, but we'll Jason that we actually tweeted, so. Anybody have any questions? Right here. Were any problems on the ship? Yes, we did. We did have some problems on the International Space Station that we had to fix. And also, you probably noticed that the capsule that we have is really kind of small. And so, I don't know if Tracy probably didn't have any problem fitting in there, but they had to get a shoehorn to fit me in there. And so that was a little bit of a problem as well, so to get in and out of this of the little spaceship that we came back in. But we did have a lot of problems, things. Just it's just like having at your home. Do you ever have things break at your home? And hopefully mom or dad are handy, and so we have to be handy as well because things break just like they do at home as well. So.
But you don't have Home Depot around the corner, That's so right. you gotta get That's creative.
Right. That's right. We do have tools on board that we can help fix the station, but and we have two bathrooms on board. So, and when a bathroom breaks down, we all tend to work together to get the bathroom fixed. So.
That's a big priority.
That's a good question. Thank you.
Are there any other questions?
Other questions? Yes.
Right here. Hi, this question is for either or both of you. When I try and imagine, 6 months living on orbit, there are things that I can wrap my brain around, like floating and the food games and everything. Were there things about living on orbit that you either didn't expect or that might not be intuitive to those of us who are stuck on the surface here? Thanks.
There's a lot about the transition you make from 1G to no G. And a lot of it are things that can be passed down, from other experienced folks, about, look out for this, look out for that. But really nothing beats being in that environment and seeing it for yourself. Something like just having a simple meal is not so simple. There is no eating on the run in space. You can't, the best you could do is something with, like a bag of nuts or a bar to eat, but even a bag of nuts, you have to make sure that you get the package closed because you set it somewhere and nuts are going to start just flowing out of it. Anything else you eat takes two hands, literally. Even if on Earth you could be watching looking at a newspaper or something and sipping something, you always have to have something secured. And as simple as that may sound, it really eats your lunch on orbit. And what you aren't necessarily prepared for is how much consideration goes into that and how much time it takes you to eat relative to what it's like here on Earth. Those are some of the simple things. Is there anything?
Well, the other thing that was kind of surprising to me is you never really get used to that. You talk about getting your mind around I don't think I ever got my mind completely around looking out of that cupola at our Earth. And because, especially when you're outside on a spacewalk, you have this kind of fishbowl bubble, that you're looking through. And it's really quite magnificent. And to the point that it's pretty distracting, actually, because you look at deep space and it's so vast and so kind of frightening, as you look off into deep space. And then you look at on the outside of the space station and the space shuttle, everything is pretty sterile looking, it's either black, white, or some sort of metallic color, so essentially lack of color. And then you look at the Earth and it's just like an explosion of color. In a sea of nothing, in a sea of very sterile vastness. And so when you look at the Earth, it's really quite distracting. It's just literally like an explosion of life and motion before your eyes. And when you're outside doing a spacewalk, that can be very distracting. And not scary, you know, but just sort of like, wow, and your mind can't really get all the way around it. And so I remember when I was back on my shuttle flight, when I did my first spacewalk, I thought, gosh, I can't wait to go into eclipse so the Earth will stop distracting me so I can actually get my work done, you know. And but then coming into eclipse and seeing what the Earth looks like in darkness is, well, just, you can't even imagine the, because now we have the aurora, we have puffs of lightning, bolts of lightning, and fingers of lightning. They're stretching out over the surface of the planet, celestial activity, shooting stars, meteors coming below us, you know, so it's very distracting, even probably more so than the daytime when you have the brilliant colors of the Earth. And so that was probably the most surprising thing for me. I don't know if I expected it to be so profound, and never really got used to it. You know, just and even today, I've been back for about 3 months, a little over three, and my mind, especially during my dreams, takes me back there. It's just an incredible experience. So.
I think that the only other thing that really surprised me, certainly everything that Doug just said about looking out the window is just so gripping and emotional. Nothing ever prepares you. These photos, we apologize, they don't do it justice, the view that you see out that window. There was rarely a visit I made to the cupola with a dry eye because it was just whatever goes through your mind when you see something that astounding and you're almost in disbelief that there you are looking at it with your own eyes. It's very gripping. But the other thing I don't think I was quite prepared for was just how familiar the space station was to me. And that wasn't because I had visited, like Doug had on the shuttle. We, both of our shuttle missions spent at least 10 days docked to the space station. It wasn't that kind of familiarity. It was you'd round the corner at night, and you wouldn't even be thinking about anything like the night of our big failure. You know, you'd just come around the corner, you'd turn off the treadmill, and you'd swing around the corner to make your way towards your crew quarter to go to bed, and all of a sudden it just hit you that you felt like you were turning a corner at home, you know, that just how familiar home is to you. And I remember that moment hitting me every now and then that this isn't bizarre to me, and to be watching my crewmates floating and upside down in front of me, talking to them, even though, you know, we're looking at each other, my hair is down, and we're sitting here, and gravity's keeping us in these seats, up in orbit as we were working and floating, and just seeing panels that we would on Earth as we're training, be looking at that panel with a specific purpose, to either open it and fix something behind it, or just understand the layout of the station. But when we got up there, it was very familiar to us. And I think it's because of the number of years we've spent training for it and being in that environment. But being up there for the 6 months, it's home to you. That is your home, and you live there. And it is familiar to you, that environment, as when you come back home and you're in the environment you've been born in. So it's I don't think I was quite expecting that either. Thanks for your question.
I've got one over here.
Is there anything strange that you can explain?
This guy.
Tracy's hair. I got back to Earth and I hardly recognized her because her hair was. That we can't explain. Well. There are, because of the harsh environment that I talked about earlier, not only outside of the space station, but inside, we're constantly bombarded with radiation that we can't really see. And but it does have an effect on our computer systems and stuff on board. And then things break, you know, that are kind of perplexing, you know, in a way, and you try to figure out why it broke. Was it the environment that we're working in, or is it more so the wear and tear on the whatever piece of hardware it is? And so there never was a day, I don't recall a day when something didn't go a little bit wrong, you know, didn't go quite as we had planned. Something would break, or we'd have to take a little time and fix something, or you know, another thing that's very important is that when you get something out, it's very important in space to put it away. I know we're taught that here on Earth as well, and sometimes it's more forgiving here on Earth, but with everything floating around, and especially tools and science equipment and stuff like that, because you're likely not going to be the next person to use that piece of hardware. And so if you don't put it back, it can get to be a little bit stressful on board because you launch an all-out search for this piece of hardware. So that's a little bit sort of surprising as well. You just got to make sure that you keep track of everything that you're working with and put it back in its place. There was another question over here, I think.
Yeah, I've got one. So kind of following up on the question before, how was the adjustment period coming back down to the ground? I'd spoken with Jim Voss from Expedition 2, and he was saying that there was a learning period for him where he would just let go of a glass, for example, and have it shatter on the ground because he had to adjust to gravity again. And I was curious to know your experience of kind of reacclimating when you came back down.
I had no experience like that. I had no problem embracing gravity, especially when it came to holding my coffee cup or something. I think that we all go through that initial period of vestibular awakening where, you know, when you just simply pitch your head forward or back, the whole world does a backflip and you are trailing behind it in that effort. So there's a lot of that going on, but I never it was like once I got back to gravity, my body knew where I was, and I never had that sensation of where I was before. And you know, and it is astounding because when you're up there and you're floating, your body has this, you know, here on Earth, your body has this tendency to be pretty straight when you're standing up, and you have to exert effort in order to bend your limbs. But in orbit, your body wants to be kind of like this. And your arms want to be naturally bent, and your legs want to be bent. In fact, you'd see a lot of our PAO events or just any time we were on camera, and we'd be holding our hands or something like that. And that's because if we let go of them, they would be hanging like this and look quite awkward. Getting back down to Earth, it was very nice to just have your arms laying there. And it takes a few days for that to actually not feel like anvils. I remember landing in the Soyuz and sitting there in my seat. And because of the way that we landed, you saw Doug and Shannon Fyodor's, their capsule was on the side. Our capsule was straight up, which isn't as typical of a landing. But laying there, I wasn't quite sure if we were on our side or not because you're so incredibly heavy. You feel very, very heavy. Right at this point, the world isn't spinning. The vestibular aspects don't really come into play when you're still crammed inside your little seat and all you have is a panel straight in front of you. What I remember feeling is very, very heavy. And unlike in the situation where your capsule lays down, and the rescue forces come into your capsule and drag you out. When you land upright, they expect you to get out. And so I remember the extraction technicians telling me to take off my kneeboard and to get out of my seat. And you might as well have asked me to climb Mount Everest without supplemental oxygen. I was like, how am I going to do that? And because just lifting my arm, was it took a tremendous amount of effort just to lift my arm, and I had very little room. You look like a, you know, I don't know, a pygmy trying to reach your stuff. And I just remember being extremely heavy feeling the moment I landed. That was the most memorable feeling I had about leaving the confines of microgravity. But
it's a good way to describe it. The thing that was lingered the longest for me, similar type feelings that Tracy had, but is relative motion between me, especially driving and running outside. I had a real issue for a couple of months. My brain trying to calculate closure rates and opening rates. If I'm running down a trail and someone's coming the other way on a bike are running, or there's a car crossing the path, you know, perpendicular. I sort of had this lag going on where my brain was trying to calculate a closure rate, and it wasn't really 100% for quite a while. So that was a kind of an interesting finding that I had in myself, you know, that after a short duration mission on the space shuttle, I never experienced that, but with the 6 months and there in your proprioceptive cues, pretty much going into hibernation, you know, for 6 months, and then coming back and asking now your that sense of your balance system there, as well as your vision, to start feeding information to how fast you're moving and in which direction you're moving, and am I in balance kind of thing, lags behind a little bit. It did for me anyway, so it's a great question.
Right. I have a question about Russian culture.
Okay. Where are you?
So I'm just really interested in the differences between training in Russia, speaking Russian, wearing Russian suits, flying in the Soyuz, and then being in the U.S. side versus the Russian side. You know, we've been told that they smell different and that, you know, that they, you know, one has a different smell, like your foods would be different. So I'm just really curious how that is and what you saw as the most unique differences between the way we do space and the way they do space.
Well,
when they opened that hatch, they smelled really good. I think we smelled really bad.
Probably shaving cream.
The extraction forces, when they poked their head in, I forget who was the first one that poked their head in, "You guys okay?" And I said, "We must smell really bad because you smell really good." And we hadn't had a shower in 6 months, but go ahead, Tracy.
No, I was just going to say that you could really answer that question in many, many ways, as you alluded to in your question, that there's many aspects of everything from the personalities and the cultural personality to just the vehicles themselves that we have, both Doug and I have had the privilege of launching in a U.S. vehicle and a Russian-built vehicle. So we're probably not going to be able to capture everything in our answer, but I'll just say one thing is that in the design of our vehicles, you know, the NASA built this phenomenal space shuttle, and its beauty is in its complexity, and it's complex because it's very redundant. If something breaks, then we've got something else to back it up, and it's an incredible. I mean, just what you know now about the space shuttle is amazing. But when you have to study it in depth in order to help operate it, then you're even more blown away than you are at first when you learn about it. The Russian system, though, is beautiful in its simplicity, and that's not to undermine their engineering, but they build things robustly. They build them to last. Where our strength is in our redundancy, theirs is in their robustness. And so the style of the vehicle itself is, when you look at it, I mean, there we are crammed in a little seat, but everything about that Soyuz is well done in what it needs to do, and its strength is in the fact that those things are gonna last. That's why we can bounce on the ground and get out walking. And then from launching in the shuttle, our shuttle is, it's got these two massive solid rocket boosters, solid fuel, bolted to a platform. And when those things light, my goodness, you feel the power of God underneath you. I mean, it's the greatest. I've lived in Southern California my whole life, and I know what an earthquake feels like. This is incredible. This is you know, power's coming from somewhere deep when those solid rockets light and you come off that pad. And when those bolts break and you lift off the pad, it's not the greatest jolt of your life. It's a deep jolt that you feel. You know that there is more power underneath you than you could ever fathom. And there's no doubt you're coming off the launch pad. In a Soyuz, it actually is suspended from the launch pad. I don't know if you could remember back to the video, but you see when the rocket lifts off the launch pad, there are these structures that fall off to the side. Those take the place of the bolts on a shuttle, which hold the solid rocket boosters on the launch pad. That's how we stay on the launch pad. And when the lift of the rocket equals the weight of it, then those things fall away because they have counterweights. So what that means to us inside the vehicle, we don't really feel the launch as much as we hear the engines going and we're looking at a clock, and when the timer comes to zero, we know that we're actually lifting off. It takes a little while to feel that liftoff, but you definitely, in both cases, shuttle and Soyuz, you feel the acceleration building on your body. So that's the kind of differences in a mechanical sense. The cultural sense is something I think some of us are still trying to figure out how we mold these two cultures together. And it's not just Russian and American. We also have Japanese as well and Europeans. But we do spend a tremendous amount of time in Russia. And both Doug and I, before we got assigned to our first flights even, when we became astronauts, we were spending a tremendous amount of time over in Moscow working to help support the space station. Spending a lot of time over there. So we became ingrained in the Russian culture well before we got assigned to these flights. And I don't know, I'm talking a lot, Will, no, if you want to jump in there with
Tracy's description of the launch is pretty accurate. I mean, the shuttle is surprisingly pretty violent in the first stage, you know, with the vibration and everything. And the Soyuz is pretty tame because you're sitting pretty much on the center line of the thrust, you know, so you could feel that you're on top of a rocket and you have a little bit of vibration laterally. A little bit of pogo vibration, but then coming home, it's a different story. It's coming home in the space shuttle is actually really, really nice and comfortable, and you have a little bit of a lateral vibration as you're coming back through the atmosphere, and not much of a, you know, little bit of a G coming on, and you take it sort of in the same axis you would in an airplane. And coming back in the Soyuz, Scott just and Sasha and Oleg just came back this morning, and I had a video conference with them last Friday to try to describe to Scott ways that he can prepare for that reentry. And it had been described to me as a series of loud explosions followed by a really bad car crash. And if you think it, if you approach it from that angle, it doesn't disappoint. It's really quite a ride back in, but just amazing that Tracy so eloquently described the simplicity of the system, but coming back home is one wild ride coming back in that little capsule, and it was totally really an eye opener, you know, a lot different than just kind of greasing it on the runway back at Kennedy Space Center like we do with the. With the space shuttle, then hitting on the Kazakh steppe, you know, and we actually they stuck their landing. They got a 10. We got about a 4, I think, on ours, because we hit and we bounced and we hit again, then we rolled over. So that was a welcome back to Earth, you know. So a lot of differences there, and Tracy described as well. It's such a pleasure working with the Russians, and for me. Especially, it's very, very profound in its meaning to me because I'm still active duty Army, and all of my training in the early years was, you know, during the years when we weren't quite so friendly to each other, and then getting the privilege of accepting command from Alexander Skvortsov, who was a Russian Air Force colonel, to a U.S. Colonel, was quite a dramatic event for me. And it really, you know, it made me think back. I remember the night before our change of command, I sat with Sasha for a couple of hours as he showed me pictures of the MiGs he was flying back in his day, you know, when we were sort of on opposite sides of the border, you know, training against each other at that time. And we just, you know, sat and wonder how far we've come just in that short period of time. And it was such an amazing moment to realize what we've prepared, the groundwork we've prepared for our children, that who's to know what's going to happen in the next 50 years of NASA and our exploring out even deeper and further, and our partnership with our Russian partners. It's just, it really has been truly an enriching experience for me personally. And very different culturally. You're very, very right. Very different culturally, but very enriching, and it really opens your eyes to the blessings that we have here, And also things, there are things that they do a little bit better than we do. And one example that I was just kind of floored by is the strength of family over there. I think it's eroded a little bit in our country, and it's kind of sad for me. But to see the strength and family over there in Russia is really quite a wonderful experience. And you know you've arrived when you're invited to the home of one of your Russian cosmonaut crewmates, and it's like it. I think it used to be here, you know. And I sort of miss. I think we, as Americans, we get a little busy, and we're a very, very mobile society now. And I think we missed out on some of that enrichment that they have in their family life. So.
Yeah, you know, my mom, I get asked a lot, how's your mom, or I guess my mom gets asked the question, you know, what does it feel like to have your daughter launch on a rocket and launch from a different country and all of that? And my mom was, she made the trip to Kazakhstan, where actually when our families come to our launch in Kazakhstan, they actually go to Moscow first, and then they go to Kazakhstan from there. My mom, you know, she's kind of used to her daughter being an astronaut now, and any parent of an astronaut knows that you accept the risk as much as your son or daughter does, but it never leaves them without feeling a little sense of need to pray for their kid. But then you add on top of that your kid going to some other country and launching. And my mom, having been through the process of watching me launch in Florida around, you know, a very familiar environment, one that, you know, you don't even have to have a son or daughter in the astronaut corps to understand, you know, what takes place at a shuttle launch. So my mom had all the comforts there. Both my parents did. But she was very... very, very, you know, because my mother grew up in that period of time where they weren't necessarily our friends, and so she had a lot of, trepidation as her daughter trekked on to Kazakhstan. But as Doug mentioned, family's a core value there, and they are a culture that when they embrace you, it's so warm. And it's so true and pure that when my mother arrived there in Moscow, she got to meet the families of my two crewmates, Sasha and Misha, and their families are just wonderful. And if it wasn't just the whole infrastructure that my mom was able to see and convince herself that yes, they do know what they're doing here, as judged only as a mother could, right? But the embrace that she received from their families was very assuring to her that they were just as real as she was. And so there's a lot of differences in our culture, but there are some very, very strong similarities. And though we speak different languages, you'd be surprised at how similarly we think and the Wranglish that can come out of out of our interactions and how far body language can go. It's it really is a very rewarding part of what we do in this international adventure that we're on.
Thank you very much, Doug and Tracy, for taking the time to talk to us today and join us at NASA headquarters. We really appreciate you coming out today and talking to us. Thank you. Thank you.